Welcome to the next chapter in grid-connected PV system, which is about PV system design. In the first teaching unit, we will deal with the PV modules. We've learned about all the main system components in the previous chapters. This chapter will now focus on the criteria we should follow to select the different components and plan a complete PV system. In this teaching unit, we'll start with the PV modules. First of all, it is necessary to decide on a specific module technology. Basically, two module technologies can be classified: crystalline silicon modules and thin film modules. Crystalline and silicon modules have comparatively higher efficiencies than thin film modules and are therefore used for the majority of all installations. Monocrystalline silicon modules have higher efficiency than polycrystalline silicon modules, but are also slightly more expensive. Thin film modules usually have lower efficiencies than crystalline silicon modules, but they also offer some advantages. For example, they can also be partly flexible, often have a homogeneous, mostly black, like shown, color, and significantly higher voltages and lower currents, and partly are more favorable temperature, have a more favorable temperature behavior than crystalline silicon modules. They are therefore used for various niche applications, such as building integrated PV. In most cases, however, the choice for a module is made between poly and monocrystalline silicon modules, whereby the trend here is towards monocrystalline silicon modules due to the higher efficiency. In addition to the selection of a specific module, the module orientation and tilt angle must be determined during system design. The question of the optimal orientation can be answered relatively simply. In the northern hemisphere, the modules should be oriented towards south. In the southern hemisphere, towards the north. The optimum tilt angle is essentially based on the latitude of the location. The further you are away from the equator, the lower the sun is in the sky on an annual average, and the greater the tilt angle should be. For the system yield, it would of course be optimal to install the modules on 2-axis solar trackers and track the sun all year round. In this case, there's no need to worry about the optimal orientation and tilt angle. However, usually the modules are installed with a fixed orientation and tilt angle, as solar trackers are expensive and require a lot of maintenance. So let's look at how we can optimize orientation and tilt. The influence of orientation and tilt angle on the annual energy yield of a module depends mainly on the location. On the one hand, the latitude has an influence, of course, since the elevation of the sun depends on it. But it is also the proportion of direct and diffuse radiation in the global radiation that is important. A high proportion of diffuse radiation means that a large proportion of the radiation is lost at greater tilt angles. In order to investigate the influence of tilt angle and orientation for a location in more detail, one first needs irradiation data for the respective location. From this irradiation data, the annual irradiation can be calculated for all possible combinations of orientation and tilt angle. We can display the results of this calculation in a contour diagram. The x-axis here shown shows the orientation, that is the azimuth, and the y-axis shows the tilt angle of the modules with respect to the horizontal surface. The ratio of the annual irradiation at a given orientation and tilt angle to the maximum possible annual irradiation is represented by different colors. Here you can see the diagram that results for Cologne in Germany. The maximum annual irradiation of 1160 kilowatt hours per square meter is obtained with an exact south orientation and an angle of inclination of 33 degrees. Especially for ground-mounted systems, where the angle of inclination can be chosen more or less freely, an optimal orientation and tilt angle is usually chosen. However, the inclination of the module also results in a problem. Shading occurs directly behind the modules. In order to avoid shading losses, sufficient distance between the module rows must be taken into account when planning the system. However, losses due to shading cannot be completely avoided, since the shadows can reach very far when the sun is low, for example in early morning hours. In practice, the optimal row spacing for elevated PV systems is calculated in such a way that the module rows do not shade each other at true noon on the day of the winter solstice, or hence the midwinter, that is the day when the lowest sun angle occurs. With the help of the sine theorem and the minimum row distance can be calculated from the equation shown here. It results from the tilt angle beta, the sun elevation gamma at solar noon of the 21st of December, and the length, or in case of transverse mounting, that is landscape mounting, of the modules. Due to the required distance between the module rows, only a part of the available area can be used. For this purpose, we define the area utilization factor F, which is the ratio of module lengths or widths L and row distance D. Now, what does that mean for a PV plant in Cologne? The optimum tilt angle for south orientation is 33 degrees here. The sun's elevation at the time of solar noon on the day of the winter solstice is 16 degrees. Let's assume that the modules are mounted in landscape format and have a width of 1 meter. With these values, we get an optimal row distance of 2.7 meter and an area utilization factor of 37%. This means that about 2/3 of the available area cannot be used. In order to increase the area utilization ratio, especially on flat roofs, the modules are usually mounted with a significantly smaller tilt angle than would be optimal for the yield. In Germany, tilt angles of approximately 10 degrees are common today. Let's take another look at a plant in Cologne. For the optimal tilt angle of 33 degrees, we calculated a row spacing of 2.7 meters. In addition, a certain distance must also be maintained to the edges of the roof, which can vary depending on the specifications of the different countries. As a general rule, 0.5 to 0.8 meter distance is recommended. Now, with a lower tilt angle, the required row distance also decreases. At a tilt angle of 10 degrees, the distance required is only 1.6 meter. The area utilization ratio thus increases to 63%. On the roof area shown here, as an example, we can now place 35 instead of 20 modules. In return, however, the annual irradiation and thus the energy yield of a single module decreases. To see how much the annual irradiation decreases due to the low tilt angle, we again look at the diagram we just discussed. We see that the annual irradiation decreases by almost 5% compared to the optimal tilt angle. Accordingly, the annual energy yield of a module will also decrease by more or less 5%. However, the energy yield per square meter of available roof area is increased overall, since considerably more modules can be installed. Also, the orientation of the modules is not always chosen according to the maximum energy yield per module. This is the case, for example, with pitched roofs, where the orientation is dictated by the roof surfaces themselves. Flat roofs can also differ from an optimal southern orientation. For example, if the modules are to be mounted parallel to the roof surface that does not face exactly south. A variation that has become increasingly popular on flat roofs in recent years is the east-west orientation. In this case, half of the modules are oriented towards the west and the other half towards the east. The angle of inclination is usually 10%, the same as for normal south-facing systems. A big advantage of the east-west orientation is that no distance between the modules is needed. The main disadvantage is the reduced annual yield compared to the optimum orientation. We again look at the example of a plant in Cologne. With a classical plant with a tilt angle of 10 degrees and south orientation, we get an annual irradiation of 95.2% compared to the maximum with the optimum tilt angle. If we now orient the modules towards the east or west, the annual irradiation drops by another 5% to 89.7%. Let's take a look at the area utilization of the roof. With south orientation, the area utilization ratio in Cologne is 63%. On our example roof, we can install 35 modules. With east-west orientation, no distance between the module rows is needed, so the area utilization ratio theoretically increases to 100%. In practice, of course, we still need a small distance for maintenance work. On our example roof, we can now mount a total of 50 modules in east-west orientation. The energy yield per square meter of available roof surface can therefore be significantly increased by an east-west orientation. Another advantage of east-west systems is often mentioned, namely that the electricity production is better distributed over the day, since the east-facing modules produce more electricity in the morning and the west-facing modules in the evening than the south-facing module. In fact, however, this effect is very small because of the low module tilt angle. For illustration here, you can see the irradiation per hour averaged over a year. The orange line corresponds to the irradiation on a south-facing PV system, the purple line to the irradiation on an east-west-facing system, both with an inclination of 10 degrees. The irradiation in the evening and morning hours is only minimally increased with the east-west orientation compared to the south orientation. The actual reason to plan a plant in east-west orientation is therefore mainly the better utilization of space. Let's summarize this unit. We've learned that we can achieve the highest yield per module by choosing the optimal tilt angle as well as the optimal orientation for a given location. When the modules are elevated, a certain row spacing must be maintained to avoid shading. We have seen that even there is a significant deviation from optimal orientation and tilt angle, only relatively small losses occur. Especially for flat roofs, the best possible area utilization plays a crucial role in the system design. Therefore, these systems are often designed in an east-west orientation. I thank you for your attention.